You know, the topic tonight, everybody's speaking in these days, 2012, the end of the world is coming, and it's becoming a massive noise everywhere you go. Even got to some of the yeshivot. People think it's maybe in the middle of the Torah, that already the Torah said that the world is coming to an end. We will try to speak a few minutes about this prophecy of the cult called the Mayan cult from Central America and some parts of South America, these Indians that have been passing their tradition also from generation to generation, and about their calendars. But before I will start, I thought that the best thing to do is to show a quick film, few minutes, to give us an idea for those who still not in what's going on here. So please, we will try to just follow this film for a few minutes and then we'll take it from there.
A significant event happened on the sun on July 31st, 2006. A reverse polarity sunspot, which is indicative of the beginning of the next solar maximum cycle, number 24. That cycle is when the sun goes into its maximum emissions activity. The peak of the sun's increased activity will occur in 2012. There's another event that was predicted thousands of years ago. That event would also take place in 2012.
The Maya built pyramids that were giant stone calendars and sundials. El Castillo, the Great Pyramid of Chichen Itza, has 365 steps and platforms to mark the days of the year. Their alignment and design is so precise that once each year they cast a unique shadow that records the spring equinox. Like the star charts of an astrologer, their codices map the positions of the stars and planets for centuries to come. The Maya calendar was unlike any other. These great years illustrate their concept of time. The hieroglyphs on the larger wheel mark the 365 days of the solar year. Those on the two smaller gears represent the 260 days of the priest's sacred calendar. Together, this Maya time machine identifies the astrological significance of every single day. Using this calendar, Maya priests predicted the precise time and place of solar eclipses. For the average Maya, it must have seemed as if their leaders controlled the awesome power of the heavens. The accuracy of Maya astronomy still astounds. The cycles of the moon were mapped so precisely that today, 1,500 years later, their calculations are off by only 33 seconds. Even the moment of Maya creation, some 5,000 years ago, is a fixed point in the sacred calendar. Forbiddingly, so too is the end of this world. Will cease to exist at precisely 4 Ahau, 3 Kenken, Sunday, December 23rd, 2012.
Will you be ready?
Right. Will you be ready? I got scared. I'm speechless now. Can we postpone the night for tomorrow, maybe? After this? All right, so let's start from the end. You can all relax. We're going to explain that sometimes the eclipse are very dramatic, you know, it makes you buy it in 1, 2, 3. But everything they say, basically, it's incorrect. From 0 to 100%, nothing to worry about whatsoever. But when we get to the second part of the lecture, we will see what our Torah has to say about the end of time. That's when we have to start worrying. But so far, nothing to worry about. Okay, so let's move on. As this is an example of one of their temples that they built. As you can see, they were very talented in many different fields, not only astrology and calculations. They were very good with that. They're also good in building all kinds of nice things. You can see all in Mexico, Peru, and other countries, many of the things that they left behind, which is, we will have to admit, that is pretty impressive. But just knowing about buildings and architecture doesn't mean you can have a prophecy. And we will address soon what prophecy is, but let's just move on to finish this first part of the lecture. Here is the second clip, please. Lights off again. The computer refused to show us the second one. I guess it's not necessary, so let's move on. And, yeah. Okay, so we can put the lights back on, thank you. According to the rumors that we hear, and it's spreading everywhere now, and I heard they're even making a movie or made a movie about it in Hollywood, according to their estimation or prophecy, the world will get to an end in December 21st, 2012, which we are very close to it. It's about 3 years from now. And in that case, what's to plan for, you know, if that's the case? But if you really search carefully about everything they wrote and everything they say, we're going to find only one thing, that their calendar, they have a calendar, their calendar is ending in December 21st, 2012. So, what does it mean? If the calendar ends at that date, does that mean the world is coming to an end? Absolutely not. Nowhere ever that they claim that the world is coming to an end. This is now, in this generation, people who like to take a little bug and turn it into an elephant. They like to add stories to the original story. The original story is not scary at all. It just said that the cycle of their calendar ends and a new cycle will begin. If some of their written books, it says that something good will come to the world. They're not talking about the destruction of the world or the sun is going to melt earth and all the other things that we hear everywhere we go. Now, as we can see, as I said before, clever, they were very clever. When it comes to math and calculation and geometry and all these things, they were very good. But they are not the only one. The ancient Egyptians, the Greeks, they had a lot of knowledge. Nobody ever turned them into prophets. What is it, a prophecy? Let's define what a prophecy is. If I say now that in 2012, 3 years from now, or even 2050, more than 2,000 yellow cabs will pass on Fifth Avenue in Manhattan between the hour 2 to the hour 3. More than 2,000 yellow cabs in 1 hour. And you wait, I don't know, 20 years, and you see that I was right. Is that a prophecy? What do you think? Something like that. It's a prophecy? Why it's not a prophecy? Because it's very probable, you know. It happens every hour for who knows how many years. What's the chance that it will stop? Very small. I'm willing to take my chance. In 3 years from now, I'm willing to swear that there will be 2,000 yellow cabs in Fifth Avenue. and maybe another 30 years from now, unless if one day they close Fifth Avenue for transportation. But other than that, for sure it will happen. So if somebody will read 50 years from now that somebody 50 years ago wrote a book and he knew that it's going to be 2,000 yellow cabs here, that's nothing. Only fools buy this kind of prophecies. I'll give you another example. If I'm saying that in Miami or in Texas, I don't know, Arizona, whatever you want, in about 60 years from now, that's going to be a very advanced military base of the United States Army, and they're going to have over there all kinds of spaceships, and I'm giving you a whole thing. And you wait 60 years, and you see that I was right. Is that a prophecy? What do you think?
No.
Why it's not a prophecy? There's more chairs here. Before you take more chairs, you have right here plenty of chairs. In the front, over there, thank you. So, why it's not a prophecy? Very simple. Maybe the engineer that planning this whole military facility is my neighbor, and we are friends, and we sit every afternoon and play cards together, and he's telling me about his plans and about what's going to happen in 50 years from now. That's all. That doesn't mean I'm a prophet. But if I write that in 2,000 years from now, at 2 o'clock in the afternoon in the city of Brooklyn, there will be a pink rain that will fall for about 25 minutes. Between 2 o'clock to 2:25, pink rain. When? 2,000 years from now. And it happened. Is that a prophecy? Absolutely yes. This is something that a person cannot predict. Even the smartest person on earth, he doesn't know that something like this can happen. First, it's against all odds. What's the chance it's going to be pink rain? Number one. Number two, the timing. If the timing was between 1 o'clock to 1:25, it's still a huge prophecy, no? According to the Torah, it's gurnish, it's nothing. If I knew that 2,000 years from now it's going to be pink rain, and I say it's going to be between 2 and 2:25, but it was between 1 and 1:25, very impressive, no? I'll still be a hero on the news. I only made a mistake by an hour, big deal. According to the Torah, it's not a prophecy. Who knows why? Why? So, a minor error. What's the problem? Because something divine must be perfect 100%. A prophecy doesn't come from the knowledge of the prophet. A prophet is only a tool, a pipe, between God and the people that live at that generation. When God has a message to send to the people, he doesn't come and collect them all in Mount Sinai like he did 3,320 years ago and start telling them what he wants from them. He did it once and that's it. That's when we received the Torah. But after the Torah was given, from time to time, God sends prophets to tell the nation some prophecies for the future. Most of what the prophets were talking is musar, ethics. What needs improvement? You should not do, stop what you're doing. This is what God expects from you. One more thing about prophecies. If the prophet comes and says, this mitzvah from the Torah, mitzvah tefillin, it's irrelevant anymore. Don't have to do it anymore. Everything else is the same, tefillin, God say no more. What do you say?
No.
We listen to him or not?
No way.
You say no way. What happens if he begins to walk on water? He walks on water like this.
No way.
Do we listen to him or no?
No.
What happens if he begins to fly?
No way.
No.
Why not? Such a person, you know anybody like that?
Yes.
The Rambam, one of the greatest poskim that we had in the last 1,000 years, he writes that when a prophet comes to say his prophecy, we're not allowed to tell him, make us a magic, a show, prove to us that you something special. And based on that, we will believe if you're a prophet or not. Because even if he flies in the air, and even if he can do all the magic you can think of, that's not an indication that he's a holy man, nothing whatsoever. What's the proof? You know, after I had a debate with that Christian professor, it's already by now a year and a half, I don't know, maybe more. I don't have 1 hour. It doesn't give me rest. Every day I get emails from Christians people that they found it. It's go from word to mouth. Baruch Hashem, believe it or not, I only had one bad comment, nasty comment, only one in a year and a half. And you know, we estimate that probably more than 1 million people saw it already on the internet. Only one nasty comment. I was expecting a lot worse. One nasty comment, and the comment wasn't about the subjects that we discussed. He just said that I didn't give the professor enough time to comment. But if you review the 3 hours, he spoke at least an hour and a half, if you measure. I don't know, but he didn't answer one question. And in the end, he said, you put me in a hole, and I don't know how I'm going to dig myself out of here. That's his words. And I told him, I just proved to you Christianity is false. And he didn't say no. He said, but my heart doesn't let me leave it. I said, the Muslims also go with their heart. The Hindus also go with their heart. Everyone goes with his heart. Heart, it's hallucinations, illusions. Real nonsense. Heart. I'll give you an example. Let's say that your cousin, your nephew, your brother's son comes from Israel to work in your business. You want to help him out. He's a young guy. He's after the Israeli army. He's 21 years old. He comes to work in your restaurant. So, you know, since he's a relative, you're not paying him $10 an hour. You want to promote him. So you give him a nice job. He's in charge of all the workers. He starts pretty good. Then you check the camera after a week or a month, and you see that besides the thousands of dollars you give him extra every month, you know, every hour he takes $100 and put donation in his pocket. Now there is a conflict between the brain and the heart, especially if you're Persian. If you're Persian, your heart doesn't let you kick him out. Why? What's the family's gonna say? What's the grandmother gonna say? How my brother gonna take it? It's gonna be embarrassment in the family. Wow, you better lose $100 every day and don't say a word until he's gonna be on the street himself. That's following the heart. What's the brain say? Get rid of him right away, ungrateful person like this. You bring him, you give him a place to sleep, you give him a job, you help him, and he spit in your face. Immediately get rid of him. What does the Torah say? Like the heart or like the brain? What do you think?
Brain,
100%. My heart doesn't let me leave it. It did so much good for me, he says, about something that doesn't even exist. It's all an illusion. It's like all these people who take drugs and they see God. One time in the middle of Shabbat, I have a lot of stories of the last 15 years. Maybe one day I write a book. For sure, it will be a bestseller. Not thanks to me, thanks to the people who make the story interesting. One time in the middle of Shabbat, one time I had a guy, Israeli guy. Oh, what happened?
It's 2012.
It's the timer. Ah, Shabbat finishing this time, no? Okay, good. Okay, now I know. Okay, so one time the story can be told in the darkness. Don't worry. One time I used to give lectures in Brooklyn on Wednesday nights from 9 o'clock in the evening until close to the morning, 4 or 5 in the morning. It was like a bus stop. Israelis are coming at any given time. 1 o'clock, another group coming in. 2 o'clock, another group came from the club. They just finished being in the club. Oh, now they're coming to finish the night with Divrei Torah. So anyway, that's exactly how it was. Baruch Hashem, more than half of these people, there was massive amount of people, today are completely Balei Tshuva, completely. Some of them in Yeshivot, some moved to Israel, Baruch Hashem. So one guy of them was a drug dealer. A drug dealer, a young guy, drive a nice expensive car. He comes to the lecture. He has a heart of a Jew. Slowly, slowly, he's waking up. He becomes Shomer Shabbat. He starts keeping mitzvot. Then I invite him for Yom Kippur. We came 2 months to Yom Kippur. The whole Yom Kippur, he was crying nonstop. Yom Kippur night, evening, after the davening, he sits with me in a deck there, and we talk about the life, about the Torah, and then he says, I want to tell you a story how I started to come to your lectures. I say, yes, how? You see, now you're lucky. There's darkness, you can walk in. Nobody see you late. She puts the light off, I think. They don't want to know. All right, anyway, so the guy is telling me a story that he has to take a suitcase. Shabbat here never ends, I see. Oh, the timer is here or it's locked?
It's here.
Very good. So what happened is, he has to take a suitcase from New York to L.A. L.A. also has a part in the story. So he brings a suitcase full of pills, drugs, from New York to L.A., and he gets $20,000 for that. And those days, it wasn't tight security like today. You have to take your shoes off, all these cameras. It was very easy. He gets on a plane with a suitcase, and he comes. Then when he's in L.A., he gets a phone call, don't get back on the plane. It's very dangerous. Somebody told about the group, come back with buses. So he takes buses, you know, just when he gets to, I think, Pennsylvania, it's very close to New York. He's sitting, actually, now I remember, the story is the opposite. He has to go to L.A., bring the pills from L.A. to New York. So he goes on a plane, now he has to come back with a bus. And he has a suitcase with 50,000 ecstasy pills inside. 30 years in prison if he gets caught, something like that. So now he's sitting in the last row on the bus, and all of a sudden, there's police check up. Two people, police, one gets in the front door, one gets in the middle door. They get on a bus. There's no way to run. And they have a flashlight, and they go one by one. Just try to imagine how this guy felt. Just when they got to the last row, he's the last one on the left. The guy looks at him. He says, what do you have there in a bag? He said, nothing, my stuff. He said, bring it up, open it. So he says to me, I started to open the zipper, I go around. Now it's 1 second before my life is ending. All I have to do is go like this, and finished. The guy screamed, we got him, it's okay. Say, you okay, buddy? He tells her out, and he got off the bus. He said, but when I took my head down to put the suitcase, how long I had to pray to God? I said, Hashem, if you save me from this, I'll give my life for you. 1 second in his mind. The guy said, we got him. You okay? So now I came to, I heard there's a lecture, so I want to now become better. No? So he's becoming better. Then guess what? He meets a girl. And she also comes to the lecture, and she also becoming a little bit religious. They go to Israel, they want to get married. So they want to get married. And I say to myself, this girl is not ready yet. So this guy is already for months. She's only a few weeks, 2 weeks. Doesn't make sense. But then, a week before the wedding, something happened. He went home and he called her, you know what. So he canceled the wedding. And now he wants to come back to New York. And everybody here tells him, be careful, don't come. They caught everyone. Everyone is in jail already. You're the only one that got away. He sent a lawyer here, check if I'm requested. Yes, no. People tell him, I said to someone, tell him not to return here. But the greed is so strong for the money. What is he doing in Israel? He's eating up his savings. He wants to come here to do another deal or two. Just when he landed in Kennedy Airport, they put handcuffs on his hand, they put him in jail, 6 years in federal prison, and then the day that he got out of there, they put him in pajama, brown pajama, they took him to the airport. Think about it, you walk with handcuffs in front of millions of people in the airport. They put him with two federal agents, they took him to Israel and released him in Israel with a brown pajama. So what he is worried about, the embarrassment that he had here and there, that everybody saw him with his clothes, in Israel everyone looks, American uniforms, the embarrassment killed him. No. Makat Choshech. You see, now we went back 3,320 years. Wow. I just hope the computer will not shut off. So, let's continue. No, I thought maybe my story will bring us the light, but... Anyway, so the prophecy, if a person makes magic, if a person makes magic, it doesn't mean that he has any power. And how do we know it? In Egypt. The Torah said that Moshe Rabbeinu threw his stick on the floor, it became a snake. What did the Egyptians do? The Torah called the Egyptians that did it righteous people or very filthy people? Very filthy people. Very impure, chartumim. The advisor of Paro, they were very wicked people. Why did the Torah tell us the story? To teach the generations to come that someone that is able to make magics is not nothing holy. It's not a prophet. And just because he can do things with kochot ha-tumah, with the impurity power, doesn't mean he can tell us anything. And we cannot rely on what they say. Same thing, those Christians that call me, they always make up the same argument. But JC went on water. So, let's say it happened, let's say. We know it didn't happen, but let's say it did. So what does it say? That he can make magics. So now take every magician that makes all these shows and make him the new prophet of the world. One thing has nothing to do with the other. Same thing, this cult, the Mayan cult. The fact that they were clever in different fields doesn't say they have a prophecy. The only nation in history that had prophecies are the Jews. No other nation in history brought one prophecy. Now I know, you may tell me, Prophet Muhammad. Prophet Muhammad never brought even one prophecy in the entire Quran. Promise you. Review the whole Quran. You don't have one prophecy in the Quran, nothing. But they call him Prophet Muhammad. Christianity, not one prophecy. Later, 200 years after the New Testament was given, the Christian church, not the New Testament, the head, the Pope of that generation, said that since God destroyed the Second Temple, it's an indication that the Jews will never return to the Holy Land. The Jews returned to the Holy Land. One prophecy they gambled and they gave, and it turns to be wrong. Nostradamus, you heard about him? Nostradamus, they made so many films about him, YouTube, here, there, books, articles. Nostradamus never gave one prophecy in his entire life. In his entire life, not one prophecy. Oh, Nostradamus brought us the light. that means I have to make tshuva. I spoke about Moshe, the light didn't come. All right. So Nostradamus, oh! Hashem didn't like what I said. Okay, I'm sorry. Moshe brought us the light. Now it's there's another timer that supervised the first timer. So, Nostradamus say only two things. And because of those two things, his followers made him a prophet. What did he say? There will be somebody called Hitler. With S, with Samech, Hitler. Right away, they say, here, he knew that Hitler gonna be. Hitler and Hitler, it's two different names. But they made him a prophet. One more thing he said, that's closer a little bit. He said there will be somebody called Michael, and he will have a birthmark. Who? Gorbachev. Michael Gorbachev from Russia. Remember he had a birthmark here on his forehead? That's it. Now they have two witnesses, Hitler and Gorbachev. Nostradamus is a prophet. Now, don't be fooled. What you read today in the internet, 99% of that, it's what the followers write after he died. After the event happened, they say Nostradamus said it. This one said it. That's nonsense. Look at the original writing. In the original writing, there is nothing whatsoever. Nothing. The Torah is full of prophecies. I'm willing to make a deal with you. You open the Torah anywhere you want, anywhere you want, and I'll show you a prophecy there. Huh? Fair deal? Anywhere you want. One time I said it in a lecture, and one Israeli wise guy, Kobe, very smart guy, but smart in the wrong things. So he said, yeah? Where is the Torah? Show me. I said, bring the Torah. My heart started to pound. Wow, maybe I made a mistake of my life. Hashem, don't let me down. The guy brought the Torah. He opened. Guess what parasha? Which parasha, every row, you have a prophecy? Every row, mamash, every row, prophecy. Parashat Bechukotai. Every word there is a prophecy. I just started a quarter of a page. I already given 6-7 prophecies. Bet HaMikdash, a nation will come, will destroy it, they'll send us to it. He said, okay, I'm giving up. He said, no, I have plenty more. I got lucky, hopefully the good one. Every page you open, you see, one time I have a friend, somebody came and told me, you know, your friend is a Kohen. Why he doesn't make Birkat Kohanim? I said, Kohen? How can he be a Kohen? He said, I'm telling you, he told somebody that his father in Israel used to do Birkat Kohanim. Well, that reminds me about another case. One guy came to the rabbi, Rabbi, I want to be a Kohen. He said, what do you mean you want to be a Kohen? I cannot be a Kohen. He said, Rabbi, come on, you know. Money solve all the problems. Here, $5,000, Rabbi. Rabbi said, I'm very sorry, I cannot let it happen, you know. He said, Rabbi, here, $10,000. Let me be a Kohen. He said, no, I'm sorry, you don't get the point, huh? Rabbi, $50,000, don't say no. Rabbi said, okay, $50,000, I have yeshiva here to keep. Tell me, why you want to be a Kohen? He said, because my father and my grandfather was Kohanim. That's what happened with you in ignorance. So he also wanted to be like his father. So this friend of mine, he told somebody that his father used to be Birkat Kohanim, something that he completely denies that he ever said such a thing. So I told him, you know what? Let's see if you're really a Kohen or not. Let's do Goral Agra. Goral Agra means you open the Chumash after you pray a special prayer, and whatever comes on the right, this is a message. So he opened. It says, Malki Tzedek, Kohen LeHashem. So here, the word Kohen came. He said, no! What, I'm sorry, no, it says, Yitro Kohen Midian. That's what came. Yitro Kohen Midian. He said, what is this? It's not a Kohen, it's Kohen Midian. We're talking about Kohen to Hashem. I said, okay, let's do it again. He said, I'm going to fool you. What am I going to fool you? I'm going to open in Sefer Bereshit. In Sefer Bereshit, the word Kohen doesn't appear. It only comes later in the Torah. So I said, do whatever you want. He opened Sefer Bereshit. Guess what came? Malki Tzedek Kohen LeHashem. He said, no, I want Kohen LeHashem. Hashem gave him Kohen LeHashem. But he still denied that he's a Kohen. Why? Because he's very old. He wants to get married. And in his age, it's probably going to find a divorced woman. If he will admit he's a Kohen, he won't be able to get married. But to marry a woman as a Kohen, that she's divorced and Chas v'Shalom have the kids Chalalim, that's better. That's what happened when you don't know that Torah is 100% divine. So let's go back to what we started with. Now the electric here doesn't work. Okay, very interesting. Okay. Let's see what the Torah has to tell us about what's going to happen in the future according to the Torah. You know, the Torah in Zechariah 14, the prophet Zechariah, he gave a prophecy about the end of time. Now, before I'm going to start naming all the prophecies about the end of time, before we go into it, I want to make sure that everybody understand the rules of the prophecies. Prophecies has two prophecies, good or bad. Some of the prophecies promising wonderful things. Some of the prophecies saying that there will be horrible things. The rule in prophecies is, if God promised something good, it's not conditional. Which means, if there is a prophecy that something good will happen one day, it's guaranteed to happen. Even, God forbid, if the Jews will betray Hashem as they did many times in the past, this prophecy will not be canceled. However, if there is a bad prophecy, tragedies, wars, all kinds of problems that's supposed to come in the future, it's subject to the behaving of the Jewish nation. If the Jewish nation make repentance, make tshuva before, any time before it's supposed to start, it can cancel all the plans of that horrible prophecy immediately. And it can turn from very bad to very good. So, even though I'm going to show you some, who knows, horrible prophecies, that doesn't mean they guarantee to happen. No guarantee. But it's up to us if those things will ever take place or not. The prophet Zechariah speaks about a war that will take place before the Mashiach will come. We know there's a tradition by us that there's going to be a war called Gog Umagog. Gog Umagog, it's a world that, according to the description in a prophecy, 2/3 of the people in the world will die instantly. In our time, we have 6.4 billion people. That means it's 4 billion people. Before everything starts, it will happen. Then there will be a period of time that the third of the Jews and the rest of the Goyim that will stay in the world, the rest, it will be a period of time that Hashem, God, will screen to see who has the merit to survive and who is not. I don't know what's going on here today. It's pressing. Nothing is working.
Can you just leave it?
Yeah. Now, oh, finally. The projector works? No. All right. I'll do it without the projector. It's okay. Shh. I would like to start showing one after one. Please pay attention to every word I say. I want to say again, it's not guaranteed to happen. It's up to us. If we behave the way we behave today, then there is a chas v'shalom, a very high chance that these things is on the way to us. But if something will happen and the Jews finally will decide to live according to the Torah and to change their habits and their behaving, everything can be reversed and turned around and completely ended differently than what the Pasuk says. Okay, so before I start, I will go by the right order. As I said, Zechariah 14, one of the options. There's few options in the Nevi'im, in the prophets. We'll go one by one. The prophet says there will be a big war. Esav and Ishmael will have a big war between them, which means the Muslims and the Christians will have a holy war. All the Muslims against all the Christians. A horrible war. And then after, they will kill one another constantly. They will stop and say, why are we fighting between us? Everything that happened to us is because of the Jews. Let's make a covenant, an agreement between us, and go attack Israel. And they do. They make peace between them. And all the nations, with no exception, will have representatives in this huge army that comes to attack Jerusalem. Right now, you see the beginning of this prophecy when every goy in the world speaks about Jerusalem. Even though in the Quran, there's not one word about Jerusalem being holy for the Muslims. Nothing. Nothing whatsoever. If any, if you read the Quran, I can show you the sources if you want after the lecture. It says clearly that Israel completely belongs to the Jews. Completely. In the Quran. This you don't hear on a mosque on Friday. Imagine a Qadi would read this from a Quran by mistake if he drank a little bit the night before. They show it on YouTube, that's the end of them. They count on the ignorance on 99% of the Muslims in the world that hardly knows how to read and write. You don't look at those you see on the news and CNN, very intelligent speakers that they know how to speak better than the Israelis. No. They learn in England and in the United States. That's why they're very sophisticated. Most of them live in the villages, go, Iraq, Saudi Arabia, even in Iran, in places they never learn how to read. They come to the mosque on Friday, whatever he wants to say, they believe. Whatever. Whatever. Whatever he's going to say, yes, sir. We that have the only truth, everything the rabbis say, million different arguments. Prove to me. How do I know? Who say we have to put yarmulke? The rabbis made it up. Prove to me. Okay, who said that he has to be black? Who said this? Who said that? Millions of arguments about every little thing. By them, yes. Yes, Mustafa. Everything you say will do. One Muslim, you can count on one hand, in a history, how many Muslims converted to Judaism? Why? Because the Zohar says that only the descendants of Esav has the merit to convert. The descendants of Ishmael don't have the merit, the Zohar says. In the last 2,000 years, I'm telling you, you can count on one hand how many Muslims converted. However, Christians, me myself converted more than 100, even though I ran away from them. It's a lot of work. I'm trying to convince them just to keep the 7 laws. They don't give up. They're willing to give everything, their wife, their family, their business to live with the kids, just to come to New York to convert. So the Zohar knew what he's talking about. Anyway, so one Muslim finally converted and now he's a speaker in Israel in seminars. One time I got into the same place where he was speaking. I stopped by and he was giving a lecture to a group of Israelis there. And I asked him one question. I told him, how did you convert? How did it start? So I was in Israel in a village. You know, they teach Islam and all this. I learned the Quran very well. And one time the teacher, he said that God left the Jews, and after they did the golden calf, from this moment on, God finished with the Jews. That's what he says. I knew Torah a little bit. So I asked him, tell me please, if that's the case, why after the golden calf, God did so many miracles to the Jews for another 40 years? Very simple question. Kindergarten knows it. My little boy, he knows it, pre-1A. He would ask the same question. But finally, one clever guy in the class, guess what happened to him? And he asked a valid question. You traitor, you this, you that. He went to his father. He had to run out of the village. Couldn't go back there because he asked this question, supposedly he's protecting the Jews with this question. The truth means nothing in all these religions and cults. You with us or you against us? The truth is, no, who cares about the truth? This is what goes there. So now, here is, the prophet said that they make peace together and they come to Jerusalem. I don't want to say all the details because it's really bad. But some of the people of Israel will run out to the borders to hide. And after they do what they do in Jerusalem, that's where God comes into action. The Olive Mountain, Arazetim, where is a big cemetery there. You know, the Arabs surrounded the Olive Mountain with a cemetery. Why? Because they read that the Mashiach comes from Arazetim. The Messiah is first steps in Israel. The announcement will come from Har HaZeitim, the Olive Mountain. So the Arab knows if a Jew goes into a cemetery, he becomes impure. how we prevent the salvation of the Jews, we surround the Olive Mountain with graves. They just forgot one mistake. The Mashiach, with all the respect, is not a Kohen. It's much, much higher than this. And these graves will not make any problems for him to walk from Har HaZeitim. They'll be very disappointed that their graves didn't help. So anyway, when this starts, it's going to be an earthquake. The mountain will break to two. One will move to the left, one will move to the right. Will be problems. And according to the prophet, it looks like either a chemical or an atomic war. Why? Because it described that these goyim will melt. Their flesh will melt. They will try to hold one another that is drowning. And when they hold their hands is melting. Disappeared. There's nothing to hold. And the pupils of their eyes are leaking like water. They melt inside their eyes and start dripping. That's what's going to happen to them. And this will be the revenge of God against all the Gentiles that made problems to the Jews for the last 2,000 years. But this is the happy end, as far as the Jews will get saved from them. But what happened until that moment? Read Zechariah 14. If you want to be up for a week. You don't want to sleep for a week, read what happened. I didn't even describe 5% of what it says over there. Then there's another prophet, the prophet Yechezkel, chapter 38. Israel. And at that day, this nation, we don't know exactly who is Gog. Some say Gog u'Magog is Russia and United States. Maybe, we don't know exactly. When it comes to the land of Israel, Ta'alech hamati be'api, that will get me very angry, God says. Ubekinati ba'esh evrati, when I'm going to be strict with my anger. Im lo ba'yom ahu yeh rash gadol ad admat Israel, there will be a lot of noise. Earthquake, the earth will shake, will move on the land of Israel. It will be so hard that even the fish in the oceans will get scared from what's going to happen. What do we say? Tsunamis. Waves of tsunamis. And the chickens and the animals and the worms and all the people and all the mountains and all the building collapse on the ground. That's what it says. Venishpati ito, and Hashem say, I'm going to do the trial for all the people on earth with fire and chemicals and all the nations that are there. All the nations. Who are these nations? We will see. Then the prophet continue. Some of the names that the Torah use or the prophets use, it's old words of cities. We don't know exactly where these cities are. For instance, Emek Yehoshaphat. It's a valley in Israel. Today, with the modern language, we don't have, to the best of my knowledge, a place in Israel that's called Emek Yehoshaphat. But it's one of the places in Israel, near Yerushalayim, a little bit further. And Hashem say, Ki yeshev lishpot et kol ha-goyim. I'm going to make trials to all these nations. And then there's another place, it's called Emek Acharut. It's also somewhere in Israel. What does it say? Shemesh ve'yareach kadaru. The sun and the moon, the lights of the sun of the moon will disappear. And the stars, you look at the sky, complete darkness. No sun during the day, no moon at night, no stars, like here tonight. Maybe Hashem wanted to give us the atmosphere, how it's going to be, you know? I didn't ask for so much help, Hashem, a little bit less. So, V'Hashem mitzion ish'ag. The shouting of Hashem come from Zion. Zion is Israel. U'mirushalayim iten kolo. From where in Israel? From Yerushalayim. V'Hashem machse le'amo. In the end, Hashem will protect his nation. U'ma'oz le'bnei Israel. And the strength of the nation of Israel. And in that day, everybody will know There won't be arguments anymore. Prove to me, where is Hashem? Where was he in the Holocaust? Where is he when the market crashed and I lost all my money? Everybody has questions. I'm sure you have some good questions for me for later. Vidatem ki ani Hashem Elokechem. You will know that I am your God. Shochen betzion, I am back in Zion. Har Kodshi, my holy mountain. Vaita Yerushalayim Kodesh. And Jerusalem will be holy. Vezarim lo yaavru babo od. Foreigners, strangers, will not be permitted ever again to step on the land of Jerusalem. Nobody, no Arabs, no Christians, all these churches, all these mosques in Jerusalem will all disappear. They won't enter anymore. And who are we talking about? The righteous Gentiles that will survive the war. Two-thirds of the world will disappear. From the third, those who will survive after a period of time. The prophets say, take 7 years to clean the bodies after this war. 7 years. All the 2 billion people that will survive will be very busy. Nobody will care about money. Can you take me shopping, darling? Shopping? I have to bury 500 bodies today. What shopping? Shopping. That's what's going to be. Read. 7 years. And Prophet Amos, Ki ne yotzer arim, the creator of the mountains, ubore ruach, and create the wind. Magid la'adam masicho, tell the human being every word that he said in his lifetime. When? In his trial, when he dies. How long is the trial of every individual? Men and women? How many? Who knows? 1 year. Yud Bet Chodesh, 12 months. 11 months, whoever say it, we say Kaddish for 11 months, we stop for 1 week and say 3 more weeks and finish. Why? Because the Zohar and the Gemara say that the trial of the wicked people is 12 months. We do not want to announce that our fathers and mothers that passed away and we say Kaddish for them, they were wicked. That's why we stop for 1 week. Like we are not giving, we're not backing it up. I didn't say my father is wicked. I'm saying Kaddish for 12 months minus 1 week. But it's really 12 months. Mishpat Reshaim Bageinom Yud Bet Chodesh. 12 months. That's why we say Kaddish for so long. What's the Kaddish? What's the secret of Kaddish, if we're already speaking about it? We say a million times Kaddish in our lifetime, and I promise you almost nobody knows what it is. Hundreds of times a week. Amen, Yesh Merabah, screaming, crying, whatever, Yom Kippur, nobody knows the secret of Kaddish. What's the secret of Kaddish? The secret of Kaddish is the secret of life. In life, we have 4 categories. Oh, now it's the microphone. Wow, the Satan is attacking me from all over. Huh?
I have a major problem.
Major problem downstairs? I tell you something, I know you won't believe me, but I'll say it anyway. Every time I came to one of my trips, and I went who knows how many times, I always suffered in the airport, Gehenom Ale Adamot. Missing planes, problem, this, forgetting this, that. So much problems. Airport was closed, ice on the floor, I had to go around and traffic and run to the plane. Today, like the President of the United States. Smooth, coming in. I thought they put American Airlines new computer, 1, 2, 3, boarding pass, coming in, 2 o'clock, the airport was empty. I say to myself, I know tonight I'm gonna pay for it. Ay, cats. All right. We don't give up. That's okay. So, why am I holding the microphone? Well, at least we're laughing in such a problematic topic. Nobody ever laughed in this topic in my whole life. All right, so, the secret of the Kaddish is that we have 4 categories in life. We have God, we have the world, we have the people, us, and we have the purpose of life. God, the world, the people, and the purpose of life. What's the Kaddish start with? It gadal v'itkadash me rabah. Speaking about God. What's the second paragraph? Be'alma dibera kirute. In a world that he created as he wished. So the second one is the world. Speaking about the world. What's the third one? Bechayechon uvyomechon. In the life of you and everyone, it's the people. And what's the purpose of life? Amen. Yehe shmei rabba mevarach la'alam. To sanctify the name of Hashem. To make it holy and precious and famous. That's the purpose of the life of a Jew. We are the messengers of Hashem. He puts us here. We are representative of the creator of all the worlds. That's why we're not allowed to look like the goyim. Even if they're very handsome, it doesn't matter. We have to look like Jews. We have to behave like Jews. We have to call our children Jewish names. We have to learn Jewish books, not all the things around, Mayan and all the rest. We have to focus on what God gave us, with the nation of the book. By the way, who gave us the name, the nation of the book? Who named us the nation of the book? Somebody that called a prophet but never gave a prophecy in his life. Muhammad, not Muhammad Ali, Muhammad. One time I saw Muhammad Ali on Broadway in a long limo, almost the whole block on Manhattan his limo was. And he's sitting in the back and his window is open. And my friend started to scream to him many years ago. And I see, I was closer to him because I'm the driver. So he goes like this, he thinks he's on a ring. He goes like this. He doesn't have eye contact with us. He cannot see anything. His head is so messed up from all the punches he got. But he goes like this. That reminds me, in boxing, when you hit the boxer, one has to fall down eventually, no? Knockout. What's the first thing the boxer that falls bleeding on the floor has in his mind? What does he care about? Boom, he just got one, you know, like in the movies, in slow motion, the sweat flying all over. Boom, he falls on the floor. A minute later, second later, the ref is counting, one, two, all the audience thirsty for blood, screaming. He gets up, and he goes like this. Why? I wasn't defeated completely. I'm still standing. That's all he cares about. All the physical pain that he has, believe me, if you know what pain they have in this situation after so many punches to the head, not from little kids. Look at the monsters that give them the punches. He gives us one punch, we don't get up from coma 20 years. If he doesn't bite our ear or something, off. So, after all his head is, he sees stars. Guess what he cares about? To get some clapping, I'm back on my feet. Why? The Torah says, when a Jew leaves this world, before all the physical punishment that he's subject to if he rebel against God, what's the worst punishment that kills him the most? The shame. It kills him, he can't bear it. And over there's nowhere to hide. Over here, we are always lying to cover for our embarrassment. You know, we don't want to be embarrassed, so we lie. Where were you yesterday? Your best friend had a birthday party and he didn't show up. Oh, I was in bed, 104, fever. If he only saw where he was. But over there, everything will be displayed. You say to your boss, I couldn't come. You know, I'm suffering a week from my back. Today I couldn't get out of bed. Now we got away with that. 6 years later, when you're going to have a repeat of your life, Magid la'adam masicho, a repeat of the life of a person, every thought he had, it's going to be displayed and analyzed. That's why it takes a year. His boss will be invited. You see where he was that day? You have to look at him now. Ah, you're back, huh? Imagine 1, 2, 3, 10 million, 5 million embarrassment, one after the other. In Israel, they had a wedding. heard that story before? In the middle of the wedding, all the gifts disappeared. You know, young couple, they got married. In Israel, people bring a lot of cash. So it's not only checks. Checks, you can call, they stop payment. No, it's also a burden, but still, you can save something. Cash, cash is gone. You don't know who brought what to bring to who, to return, to make the famous list. You don't know. They run around, they're crying. What a horrible end to the wedding. Gone. 3 weeks later, they get the video of the wedding. They get all the neighbors, the relatives, everyone they could invite for that grand display of the wedding. Just an hour and a half into the wedding, then the guy said to his wife, look, the bag of the checks is still there. She said, maybe we get lucky to see who took it. You know, there's a lot of cameras, maybe he didn't realize. A minute later, they hear a chair flipping over. Boom! You know, the floor in Israel is not like the wood here. They hear, boom! They turn around, who do they see? One guess. The father of the bride fainted. Everybody turned his face to the screen. Ah! The screen here can be displayed with the light. It doesn't have to be automatic. You know, but why? This for the boarding pass, that it was too easy. So anyway.
High voltage, that's a problem.
Voltage? I didn't know I have so much electric in me. So anyway. So the father of the bride stole all the checks. And the 1 minute embarrassment, he couldn't take it. He fainted. The body has a protection, like here. When there's high voltage, the light goes off. The body, when there is high embarrassment, not voltage, high embarrassment, the shelter goes off. The person faint. He can't take it. Let's continue. Every time the electric goes off, it messed up the computer also. Very interesting. No? No? Okay, here. Hine yamim baim. You know, Kabbalah, everybody speaks about Kabbalah. You know, according to the Zohar, 15 days before Mashiach comes, before everything will start, there will be 15 days of darkness in the whole world. No sun, no light. 15 days. Everything here is the opposite. Right? All right. That's the light before the darkness. I shake it. Anyway. Oh. So, let's see what the prophet Amos has to say. Hinei yamim baim. This is about our generation. It started 20 years ago, this prophecy. Tell me if I'm right or wrong. Hinei yamim baim neum Hashem Elokim. Here days are coming, the speech of God Almighty. Veishlachti rav ba'aretz. I'm going to throw hunger in the world. Which hunger? Not hunger for food. The house is full of wealth. Plenty of food, bread, meat, chicken. Even in a financial crisis, we still eat good, Baruch Hashem. Too good. Yeah, look at the average stomachs that we have. You know that we eat too good. People who learn a lot of Torah don't have time to eat good. You know, the Chazon Ish sometimes forgot to eat 3 days in a row. 3 days in a row. He didn't go to sleep and he didn't eat for 3 days. Why? He was so in the Torah, he didn't remember that 3 days passed. When a person enjoys, time loses essence. You know, you don't know what's going on here. So I'm going to throw hunger in the world. What kind of hunger? Not hunger for bread or thirst for water, but to hear the word of God. Everybody, even the goyim, not only the Jews, the whole world, in these last 20 years, is searching for God, for spirituality. Muslims, Christians, Buddhists, and Jews, of course, hundreds of thousands of Baalei Tshuva in the last 20 years, all over. It's easier today to make people religious than 20 years ago, for sure. Why? 20 years ago, everybody thought we're already religious. They keep a holiday or two. They put tefillin when the Chabadni guy comes once a month. We are Masorti. We're traditional. We're Masorti. You know what Masorti means in Hebrew. How do you call a sword in Hebrew? Masor. It's Masorti. You know, in the shape of a T. Every day they cut another mitzvah. Masorti. Masorti. So, ונאו מים עד ים מצפון עד מזרח. Everybody search for God all over the world. This is what's happening to us today. Then we continue. והיה בית יעקב אש, the nation of Israel will be the fire, and the nation of Esav will be the straw. How much we suffer from the Christian nation in the last 2,000 years. How many hundreds of millions of Jews they killed? You only know about the last 6 million 60 years ago. Did you know about the 20 million that they killed in Beit HaMikdash? Did you know about Aruge Beitar? Did you know about hundreds of thousands in each pogrom that they killed? Do you know how many trillions and trillions of dollars they stole from the Jews and took their property and real estate until this moment? Just somebody told me, I was in Shabbaton in Englewood by Persians there. And he told me now recently in Iran, there's a very ancient old shul, I think in Isfahan, like more than 1,000 years old, that shul. They told them, you have to supply us with the deed of the building. They know there's no deed. It's a shul that's going on for hundreds of years. What deed? You have a shul from 1,000 years ago, you can supply with the ownership? They say, what? We've been here for 1,000 years. What ownership? They took them out of the building, they knocked it down, the shul, and they built their hotel over there. Here now, in I don't know how many years ago, 10 years ago, something like that. They did it to us, constantly around the clock, all the Jews from Iraq. They all had to escape from Iraq, they took all their property. When Khomeini came to Iran, you know how much property the Jews left and escaped? I know one guy, he had streets in Iran, streets full of houses and buildings. It's still there. Cannot go and take it. Multiply it by the last 2,000 years. Take the 210 years that we were slaves in Egypt, add everything up. They owe us a lot. When is going to be the time of revenge? It didn't start yet. Right here. This is this prophecy of Prophet Ovadia, chapter 1. The nation of Israel will be the fire. And the nation and the descendants of Joseph, which is Israel, the dear son of Yaakov, will be the flame. And the nation of Esav will be the straw that would light up. And there will not be anything left from them. Here, the word of the prophet. Now, the difference between these prophecies to the nonsense prophecy that I showed you in the beginning of this lecture is that this is real. Nobody can change it. Unless if this goyim will make tshuva. Even goyim can make tshuva. How do I know? I have news for you. You may not know. A goy can get almost to a level of the Jew. Almost. First of all, if he converts, he's a Jew in the highest level. And it's nothing to talk about. He's a Jew, one of the best. Second, if he did not convert, he's still a goy and he keeps the 7 laws that he has to keep. He's a righteous goy. He can make tshuva and he can go to heaven in his level, lower than the Jews, but still heaven. But you know how many Jews have no share to the world to come because they're not keeping certain important mitzvot from the Torah? Not every mitzvah that we don't keep from the Torah makes us lose the share that we have to the world to come. No. Not everything. If we stole here a little bit, we paid double, but we don't lose our share to the world to come. If we ate non-kosher here and there, we don't lose our share to the world to come. But if we violate Shabbat, knowing it's a holy day, we light fire, we don't care, right away we lost our share to the world to come. Why? It's the covenant between the nation of Israel and God. Based on that, there is a world to come. Thanks to that. If you don't keep that, there's nothing to think about. Or if we worship idols, if a Jew worship idols, Shem Yerachem, and he didn't make tshuva for it, that's it, he lost it. If he ate on Pesach Chametz, pay attention, those are the souvenirs for the exodus of Egypt. The memorial mitzvot that Hashem put in the Torah that is an exodus, it's as a memory of the exodus of Egypt, there is no tolerance whatsoever. That's why Shabbat, it's a covenant. What do we say in the Kiddush? Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim. Zecher Litziat Mitzrayim, Tfilin. Karkafta delo manicha Tfilin, nikra poshea Yisrael begufo. A Jewish calf that does not put Tfilin every day, God announced him as a criminal of a nation of Israel every day. Who wants to be in this category? Raise his hand. That God puts him in a category, a criminal of my nation. Why? Why? Not because he didn't go to college. If he didn't go to college, he's not a criminal. Maybe he won't find a shidduch, because everybody wants professional all of a sudden. Ma'anyen. But he's not a criminal. He can be the head of the Supreme Court in Israel. And in the eyes of God, he's the most criminal Jew on earth. But he went, he has 5 degrees, masters and this from Oxford, from Harvard, what? But he doesn't care about me, Hashem said. Mishamayim ishkif Hashem. Hashem is searching from heaven every day. Lirot. Ayesh maskil doresh el Hashem. Hashem is searching all over to see who is a wise, smart guy or girl. Who is a smart person? What's the definition of a smart person in the eyes of God, in His Torah? Doresh el Hashem, searching for God all the time. Searching for God when he sees the leaves falling from the tree, pick up one leaf, he look at the design of the leaf, he is so amazed. If he could, he run and kiss God, if he could. Just from the creation, wow. I showed the little kids in the neighborhood the leaves, to get them used to think when they're young, don't take everything for granted. You eat steak. Did you look at the meat? How it's organized in beautiful lines, the meat. Beautiful. Look. Break it with a fork. See how they all like stripes of meat. Did you ever open an orange? You open the inside. Do you see all these bottles? They're all in the right order. Did you ever open an orange and you saw one of them the opposite? They all stand in a beautiful order. There's one great film that came out in Hebrew and in English. A friend of mine, Shimshon Halperin from Muncie, he is behind this project of showing all this Abba Asher Yatzar that you see in the, next to the bathrooms, all this blessing that they show pictures of the body, he makes it. And now they made a beautiful 1-hour film about the wonders in the body. They show doctors from hospitals, they describe the heart, the lungs, the stomach, the brain. Amazing. Very good. Shows how many miracles we have every second in our body and we don't pay attention to it because we got used to it. Ve'alu moshiim be'ar Tzion. Maybe it's the air condition. It's better to sweat than to be in the dark, no? ועלו מושיעים בהר ציון לשפוט את הר עשיו. The savior that comes from the mountain of Zion will make the final try to the descendants of Esav. The prophet Micha, don't lose concentrations even though we're in the dark. The message can still pass. I'm reading, pay attention. והיה באחרית הימים, in the end of days, יהיה הר בית השם נכון בראש הערים. The mountains of Hashem will be highlighted above all the other mountains. Ve'naharu alav amim. It's the air condition, I'm telling you. If he puts off the air condition, it's going to work. Huh? Yeah, that's no other explanation. Please, shh. How do we know now it's Be'acharit HaYamim? How do we know? The world is set for 6,000 years. We are in 5,770 years. Five more minutes and I'll start with the sessions of the questions and answers. So if you have questions, please prepare them now. The Torah says the world is set for 6,000 years altogether. We are in the year 5,770. Which means we have maximum 230 years to the end of this world. But the Torah Chazal says, Ba'elef ashishi velo besofo yavo agoel, in the last thousand, which is the sixth one, but not in the end, the Savior will come, approximately 200 years before, which means it's in our time, within 30 years from now. It can be in a year, it can be in a week, it can be in 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, it can be in our time. Most of you are very young people here. In our time. And if you take 6,000 years divided to 24 shares, each part is 250 years. Take 23 times 250 from the 24 parts, take 23 are behind us. 23 are behind us. 5,750 are behind us. We are now 20 years into the last part, which is 250 years, minus 20 years that we already in it. This is the last 230 years of the creation. Now, in case you are wondering, how can the world be only 6,000 years old, when everywhere you go on Discovery Channel, they say 15 billion years ago, 300 trillion years ago, etc., etc. The answer is very simple. When you go into my website, divineinformation.com, the first two films on the top, I put it in the head of the list. There's a very, very long list of hundreds of lectures in English and in Hebrew. But the top two on the list are two movies that were made by American scientists, not Jewish. Among them, Robert Gentry is a very famous scientist. They prove that the world is only a few thousand years old. And they disprove all the nonsense that the other says scientifically, not based on belief. Watch it. You'll never ever think that the world is millions of years old. In case you are not convinced yet, I will ask you one question and we move on. If we have one person in this room, Avi, and we want to know how old is Avi, how old is he? So I guess that he's 20. He says he's 21. He say 22, 23, 17, 30, 40. Everybody give Avi a different age. Is it possible that all of us are right? Or in the best scenario, maybe one of us is right. Maybe, it's no guarantee, maybe we're all wrong. In the best scenario, maybe one of us is right. You agree? Cannot be that all of us is right. Either 20 or 30. It cannot be both. Please explain me how there is thousands of scientists and thousands of universities, non-stop, many, many researchers, again and again and again. And each one of them come to different conclusion and different results. One say the world is 10 million years old. His friend from the same university a year later say 300 million. Where is 10 million? Where is 300 million? A year later, 10 billion. F or 10 million, where is 10 billion? And they all use the same books, the same background. They went to the same courses in university. So, if they all came to different conclusions, why would I waste a minute on them? Why would I waste a minute? If they themselves contradict everything they say. We have one age, it's the age of the Torah. The Torah knows the best. And don't think, oh, but wait a minute, there's dinosaurs and this and that. Yes, there is. It's true. Used to be big, giant animals. The Gemara speaks about it. And they died 4,200 years ago when the flood covered the whole world. There was a flood, Mabul. 40 days nonstop rain. They all died. They couldn't enter the ark. They were too big for that. That's why they found their bones. And the bones are 4,200 years old. That's all. And if you watch the movie, you won't believe it. It shows you three different pieces of wood. One that they say that is hundreds of millions of years old. One is a few thousand years old. And one is 3 months old. And it shows you in a microscope that they all exactly the same. There's no difference whatsoever. So why this is millions of years and this is only a few days old? They show that they put chicken bones in a construction site. Chicken bones! Chicken bones. 3 months before they found them, they say they're millions of years old. Such ridiculous things. You have to watch this. If you don't watch it, you don't believe how nonsense, how ridiculous it could be. How much ridiculous. This is a scientist. It's not a rabbi, not a Jew. He proved what they say. It's wrong. Let's move on. So the Torah say, we are now in the last quarter of 24 quarters, which means Erev Shabbat. Shabbos evening. The day starts in the evening before. We are now in Friday night. Shabbat starting any minute. Shabbat is the 7,000 of the creation. There will be 1,000 years here that all the righteous Jews from all the previous generations will come back to life. The resurrection of the dead. Chiyat HaMetiv. In case you wonder how can it be, how can it be that David HaMelech will get up from his grave and start walking in Yerushalayim and everybody will look at him? Or Avraham Avinu and all the others, all the Tanaim, the Amoraim in the Gemara. Don't be so surprised. What's a bigger miracle? To take a skeleton from a grave and do hocus pocus and make it a person? Or to take a drop of water and go like this and make a person? What's a bigger miracle? To make a person from a drop of water or to make a person from a skeleton with bones and head? Just have to put the ligaments and on it. What's a bigger miracle? The answer is to make it from a drop of liquid is a much bigger miracle than to take a skeleton from the grave and make it a person. We are made from a drop of liquid, in case you forgot. Where we came from? Da me'ayin bata, the Gemara says. You should know where you came from. Before who you standing? And where are you going? Where are you heading to? What's going to be after 70, 80 years? Where are you heading to? Who's going to eat your body? That's what the Gemara says. And the most important thing, never forget who you're going to be judged in front of. For every good thing you did and every bad thing you did. So, yes, it happened already once in history, in the time of Prophet Yechezkel. The resurrections of the dead happened once in history. The tribe of Ephraim escaped from Egypt before Moshe Rabbeinu gave them permission. They escaped from Egypt. And what happened to them? They all died in the desert. And then Prophet Yechezkel, it's about 700 years later, he's coming to that valley and he sees thousands of skeletons all over. No flesh, no nothing, no bodies. Only bones. And the bones are broken to pieces. The hand is here, the head is there. Pieces, not complete skeletons. And this is what the prophet says. Chapter 37. Aita la yad Hashem, the hand of Hashem was on me. In the spirit of Hashem, he took me from my place. He was in Babel, in Iraq. And he put him somewhere between Egypt to Israel. We don't know exactly where. That's where all the bones were. And it's full of bones. And he passed me through. He made him a tour around the bones. Plenty of bones in the valley, and they're all very dry. Falling apart. Vayomer Eli, and God said to me, Ben Adam, hey, mister, atichyena atzamot haele, you think these bones can revive, can come back to life? Vaomar Hashem Elokim atayadata, dear God, you only know. Instead of saying, sure, he said, you know. Vayomer Eli, Inave, start saying your prophecy to these bones. And tell them that I'm bringing their spirit back to them, and they will live. And I will bring back their ligaments and flesh and skin and put the spirit in, then they will revive. And I started to see the prophet say the ligaments are built into their body and flesh and skin, but they still don't have the spirit. It's dead bodies on the floor. But all of a sudden you see people. Until now it was only bones. Vayomer Eli, continue to say your prophecy, don't stop. Va'amarta el ruach, speak to them, speak, call the souls to return back to their bodies. This is what Hashem says from all sides of the world. All the spirits return to these deceased people and they should revive. And I said my prophecy as God ordered me, and the souls returned back to them and they got back on their feet. It was a massive noise. And Hashem told me, dear Yechezkel, you should know, this is all Jews, the nation of Israel. Ha'atzamot ha'ele, Bet Israel Emma, they're all Jews. That the Jews say, how can it be the resurrection of the dead? Our bones is already dry in the grave, and we lost our hope. Now, that's why you say your prophecy and tell them, I'm gonna open your graves and take you out of your graves, my nation, and bring you back to the nation of Israel. When? Very soon. Much sooner than what you think. It's going to happen, because as soon as Mashiach comes and this huge war will be, don't think that the actual world will take years. No. The Gaon Vilna say the last war will take 9 minutes. Everybody laugh. 9 minutes? The Gaon Vilna was 250 years ago. There were no bullets. No bullets. No machine guns. Nothing. How can you destroy the whole world in 9 minutes? With bone and arrow? Everybody laugh. The Jews are hallucinating. Look what happened to the rabbi. 9 minutes. Today it's very realistic. 9 minutes. What's going to happen after these 9 minutes? Hashem Yirachem. The last minute before I open the permission to ask questions is, you should know I'm your God that take you out of your graves and I put back the spirit and bring you back to Israel. I am the God who promise and keep my promises. I'm not a member in the Israeli Knesset. One member in the Israeli Knesset, you know, he became old and he passed away. So he came to God and he said, wow, dear minister, you put me in a very bad spot, God says to him. I don't really know what to do with you. Everybody respected you on the news and the media, all the secretaries you have. Somebody like you, I cannot send to hell, you know. But at the other time, I'm not so happy from you. You know, you didn't keep Shabbat, you didn't put tefillin. I never saw you once opening a siddur, reading one tefillah. So I cannot put you in heaven. So I really don't know what to do with you. So you know what? Since I don't know what to do with you, I will make you a Torah. You see what's going on in Gehinnom, in hell, and then you see what happens in heaven, and you tell me where you feel more comfortable. So the guy, the minister, was very impressed. Okay, very good, God, no problem. So he take him to hell. He see in hell all the rock stars with guitars on the bars, the models, jet ski, you know, people jogging, Olympic games, movies, beautiful, wow, breeze. This is hell? Ah, I couldn't even get something like this in my lifetime. So, okay, I got it. Let me see heaven now. We take him to heaven, he see one speaker giving a lecture, everyone is looking at their watch, when is it gonna end? The light is on and off. I say, listen, Meyer, take me back to hell. God say, you sure? That's it, it's a final decision. He said, yeah, well, what's to compare? Come on, it's a show starting there, quick. They open the door, the angel says, "S'il vous plaît, monsieur." Go in. He comes in, shock of his life. Smoked people, skinny, bones, walking with heavy things on their back, crying, fire from all over, horrible mountains of ashes. "What's this? That's not what you showed me before." He said, "No, that's it." He said, "Come on, that's not it." "No, that was before the election, now it's after." "But you promised your voters." "That's before the election. Before the election, they fixed the highways. At least this is the way it is in New York." Okay, listen, there's a lot more to say, but we should conclude with one last sentence that Hashem said to us. We shouldn't lose hope. Shuva Israel ad Hashem Elokecha. Return to me, the nation of Israel. Ki kashalta va'avonecha. You fell with all your sins. Now it's time to return. Kru imachem dvarim. Take with you words. What words? Sports? Politics? What Hashem is interested in? Torah. Bring with you words. Veshuvu el Hashem and return to God. Mi chacham ve'yaven ele. Who is the wise guy to finally understand that the ways of Hashem are straight and righteous? Righteous people will follow it and wicked people will fail in it. Which means it's a free choice. Everything you have in life you can use for good, you can use for bad. Depend who you are, what you do, what you chose to do. The sun will turn to darkness. The moon will turn to blood before the big judgment, horrible day of God. Prophet Yoel, chapter 3. And everyone will scream in the name of Hashem. If you have enough merit to scream, "God save me," you will get saved. There will be survivors in Jerusalem. Survivors, that means chas v'shalom, many will not survive. As Hashem says, I want to see just if I conclude more or less everything. Of course, there's a lot more. Oh, don't lose your hope. Wait for Mashiach. Chakelo, wait for him. Do not give up. For sure he will come. Even if there is a delay, he will come in the end. And this is the sentence that the Chilonim, the secular Jews in Israel, say it all the time when they argue with the religious people. "Leave me alone. You live in your life. Let me live in my life. I don't tell you what to do. You don't tell me what to do." Right? Fair deal, no? And what is the word, the verse from the Torah that they use to back them up? Ish be'emunato ichyeh. Oh, you're beginning to laugh. That means you're educated already. Ish be'emunato ichyeh. Show me where does it say in the Torah, "Ish be'emunato ichyo." It doesn't say "ish," it says "tzaddik." They made one little change. One little change. It's like not putting the dot in a www.puretorah.com. Just forgot to put the dot. Press enter, doesn't come. The dot. What is the big deal? They took the word "tzaddik" and changed it to "ish." Ish be'emunato ichyo. Everybody can live the way he wants and no problem. Tzadik be'emunato ichyeh means only the righteous people will survive thanks to their faith in God. Complete different meaning. Nowhere in the same Torah that the religious people allow to leave the non-religious people alone. They have to do everything they can to beg them to do anything they can. If they have money, so give them money. If they have talent and charisma, whatever they have, to save them before the eternal spiritual death. Eternal. If your brother is about to drown in a swamp, you speak to him nicely, "Dear brother, please come out of there." "No, Moshe, leave me alone, I'm depressed." No, please, don't do it to mommy. "Come on, get out before I don't know what I'm gonna do to you. First break his head, put him to sleep, get him out, tomorrow we'll fight." One guy in Israel, oh, you're going to love this one. He's Shomer Shabbos and about to marry Christine in London. True story. 10 years ago. Christine is waiting in London. He met her through the internet. his friends tell him, what are you doing? Shomer Shabbat. Well, you know the truth. If you didn't know the Torah, no. You know it's a horrible sin to marry a Goya. I can't help it. I fell, you know, fell in love. Fell. I fell in love. I never had a girlfriend. It's the first time. She treats me very nice. Don't worry, one day I'll convert her. Whatever they did, they cannot convince him not to get on a plane. Comes the day of the flight, his three friends, they told him, okay, look, come, let's drink l'chaim. At least you don't listen to us. At least we wish you mazel tov. What can we do? The fool believed them. And he came. As they say, hey, listen, don't forget, you want to convert up? Before he realized, they pushed him in a room and locked the door. True story, it happened in Israel. What are you doing? Open the door in your dreams. You have over there food for 3 days and there's bathroom on a corner. We'll see you in 3 days. Scream, I'll sue you, I'll do this, I'll kill you. Open the door. His friends say, on my dead body, what do you think, I'm going to let you destroy your eternity? You can kill me after. I did my obligation. Open the door, it's a free choice. You cannot do it, you're not my father. They didn't open the door. After the date of the wedding passed, for sure, they released him from the room. He's going crazy, he runs to the phone. Christine, you're not gonna believe what happened. You dirty Jew, she started to curse him on the phone. Before he opened his mouth, he thought, Hitler is speaking on the other line. All the anti-Semite comments that you can think of, you this, you that, hey, I knew I shouldn't mess with you. He was in shock, but for the first time you can see half a smile on him. What did I get saved from? His friend said, please forgive us, we mean well for you. No, I owe you my life. If you hear what she told me now on the phone, when he told her that his friend closed him in a room, she started to curse even more, his friends also. This is what we had to do. Well, we're not strong enough. So the minimum we can do is give out CDs, inviting people to the website to watch lectures. $1 CD, that's it. It can save families. I can say guarantee with a hand on my heart, that since we started giving out thousands of CDs, we've just been in a Knicks game with Maccabi in Madison Square Garden, we gave thousands of CDs there. We give CDs constantly, even I brought CDs here. We're counting on good heart of the people that donate some money, 100 here, 500 there, and we add it together, we make CDs, we give them out for free, and people become religious, many people. And I always tell the people, listen to me, you donate from your 10% income, whatever you can, 100, 200, whatever you can, you donate and we make CDs, I give you the CDs, give them out yourself to your friends. You buy them, you give them out. $1 each, DVD, 3 hours knowledge. Let's say the guy will not make one mitzvah after he watches it. It's almost impossible. But let's say, all the 100 CDs you gave, nobody became religious. No, let's say. So you spend $100 from your tzedakah money. Each Jew that watched it learned more than 3 hours Torah. You know how much is an hour of learning Torah? 60,000 mitzvot. In 1 minute, a person can say 200 words. In an average word, there is 5 letters. It's 1,000 letters a minute. Each letter counts as the biggest mitzvah in Judaism, learning Torah. Limud Torah keneged kulam. Multiply by 60 minutes, it's 60,000 hours. 3.5 hours of this Torah in the DVD, it's 200,000 mitzvot. Multiply by 100 Jews, how much is that? 20 million mitzvot to your bank account in Shamayim. For how much? For $100. You build 500 synagogues with your billions of dollars, you won't make it. For $100. And I'm not exaggerating. Don't think I'm crazy. I will do the calculation with you. How many prayers they're going to have there? 20 people here, 20 in the afternoon, 20 at night, whatever, all mitzvah de Rabbanan. No, Baruch Hashem, you made 100 mitzvot today. Tomorrow, another 100. Shabbat, another 500. Calculate how much. And it's cost fortune. Cost fortune. To buy money for poor people, you need to give them at least a few $100 for a good meal or two. It costs you fortune. One mitzvah. You feed them once, one mitzvah. Tomorrow again, another mitzvah. Five people, five mitzvot. Five mitzvot. To save souls, not only the actual hour that they learn while they're watching the CD or listening to the audio in the car, sometimes they hear it twice because they're not sure they understood everything. It's enough they make five mitzvot and they do it for the rest of their life. Every time they do it, it goes to your account. Shh, wire. He kept Shabbat, goes to you like you did. He put tefillin, goes to you. He became a speaker. He became Daniel, makes Torah, pure Torah, with thousands of people every day listening. Whoever made him religious, it all goes to his account. Very good, no? But nobody has the brain to do it. The people will give money to everywhere, to the Israeli army. For what? That they smoke on Shabbat and play billiard, with all the respect. It's important. But it doesn't come, not even millionth, compared to learning Torah. Because we go by what Hashem said, not what we think. It doesn't go by our heart. With all the respect, we have a lot of gratitude to the soldiers. I myself was a soldier. My family, everyone, no problem. We are chas v'shalom, not disrespecting anyone. They deserve all the thank you in the world and appreciation. We go by investments now. With appreciation, you don't build a castle. Somebody say thank you to you, you still don't have what to eat. We talk how much you earn. How much you earn, this is what the bottom line comes. You have a little money to give, you have to know where to invest. My advice to each one of you, only give charity to saving Jewish souls. The Jews in this generation are very thirsty for spirituality. They just don't have the direction. You make flyers, give them pure Torah, Torah Anytime, divineinformation.com, Idabru, there's a lot of good websites with plenty of learning. Sometimes you send a list of emails to hundreds of people. It costs you penny, nothing. 5 minutes of your time, you build up a list, you send. There's a great lecture. 10, 20 of them will watch, you just made a million mitzvot. Nobody uses a head. How hard it is to put tefillin, one mitzvah. Shema, one mitzvah. Making bracha, birkat hamazon, three mitzvot. Putting tzitzit, one mitzvah. No? Giving $100, 100 CDs to people. This guy gives it to the neighbor. I made one guy religious with Hashem's gift. It was a gift. That I met the right guy in the right time. And he made all the films that you see today in the world. He made so many people religious with his movies. Every movie that came in the last 10 years he made. We made the first movie together in Formatzia Elokit 11 years ago. It was the first movie in a Jewish history. Nobody knew about movies to make people religious. It was the first when the video cassette came out. It wasn't even the DVDs. And everybody saw the effect of this video. And all of a sudden, everybody started to make DVDs, CDs, movies, and Baruch Hashem, it's working. The generation today only understand media. Nobody has patience to buy books and to read books anymore, unfortunately. So what the books say in 7 hours, in half an hour, you show him on the screen, he gets the same message. And it costs $1 only. This is it. Be'ezrat Hashem, I'm opening now. If any questions you have, not necessarily about what we spoke only tonight, any subject, any topic, please. Yes.
About prophecy was like earlier in the discussion, just right now too.
Yeah.
About how we're not supposed to follow our hearts. We're supposed to follow our minds.
Right.
But I mean, for many of us, the reason we want to be Jewish, the reason we're connected to God, the reason that we're living this type of life instead of a secular type of life, it's not because we know in our mind that it's true. For many of us, it's because we feel it in our hearts.
It's not supposed to be that way.
Based on the knowledge that we know, it's not so clear cut that this is true and this is not true.
It's very clear, very clear. It has to be educated. You see, if you watch my film Torah and Science, you will never ever have a doubt if what you do is 100% correct or not.
Even if I watch
proof it, scientifically.
Find 10 other scientists to say the opposite thing.
No.
So I want to believe it, but yeah. I'm saying I will never believe 100%. So I think that the reason we decide to do something, even though maybe our brain's not doing this, because of our heart, no?
Yeah. Let me tell you something. If God says in the Torah, you should know me, you should know I am, you should know, you should know, you should know, never, ever God used the word you should believe. Only once the prophet Yeshaya say you should know and believe me and understand that I am the one and there's no one but me. Only one time he used the word believe, emunah. Everywhere else in the Torah, v'yadata ayom, and you should know, leman, dat, kol ame haaretz, da, everything is knowledge language. Tell me, God made a mistake? He refers to us, you should know that I am the one and my Torah is divine and nothing else is real. How do you do it? How do you do it? You put 10 hours of your time, you learn all the scientific proof, and there's hundreds of them, hundreds. You see the prophecy, you see everything fell into place, and you can see right away that the Torah can never be written by a human being. There's so much knowledge about nature, nobody would ever know such thing. Watch the seminars that we do. Go into my website, you have about 10 of those films. After you watch it, it will be very, very clear. That's not the problem. Allow me to disagree with you. I don't think that the main problem is if it's real or not. It's very easy to prove. The problem is the Yetzer Hara. We have evil inclination that fighting against us and make us weak. And the solution for the Yetzer Hara is to learn Torah. If you don't learn Torah one day, you become very weak. You must learn Torah. Yes, over there. Yes.
I wanted to know for the resurrection of the dead, if you come into the life a few times, like to correct your soul, which person comes back?
Which body?
Yeah.
The most righteous body out of all the bodies that the soul was in. If the soul was in 10 different bodies, the body that had it gave less problems to the soul, that's the body that will have the merit to resurrect. And also, you should know also the resurrection of the dead is only for the righteous Jews who lived in the past. Not every Jew is resurrecting. Only those who are righteous in previous generations. They made even a joke about it, that two Jews came to buy a grave. One is not religious. He comes to the cemetery owner. He says, I want to buy a grave. He says, yeah, $1 million. $1 million for a grave? He says, yeah, it's very prestigious area here. Real estate is very high. Then a minute later, he sees a Hasid with a, you know, yarmulke hat, comes in. How much a grave? $2,000. Not far from him. So, well, you say real estate is high. $1 million, $2,000, what's going on here? He says, you don't understand. For him, it's only rent. It's going to be, who knows, a year, two, five, ten. Comes the Mashiach, he gets up, I get back the space. For you, it's forever, my friend. $1 million cash. Yes?
Follow up on the gentleman's question.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not a Torah scholar. I'm trying to find my way and trying to absorb as much Torah as I can. I know Rabbi Phil Chernofsky said, if you think that there is a conflict between Torah and science, either you don't know enough Torah or you don't know enough science or both.
Right.
And Rabbi Abraham Greenbaum explains it this way, to say that the 24-hour day was initiated when the Nishama came into Adam. And for me, that's a lot better way to harmonize what the Torah says with what science says. And with all due respect to everything that you've said, I've listened to every word. When you look at the wood under a microscope, it doesn't tell you anything. What matters is things like carbon dating. Very precise. Very precise. You know, the age of the universe. Very precise. The scientists don't argue this point. They all know it's more or less 13.5 billion years old, give or take, but they're all in the same general area. Same with the age of the Earth. They all say 4 billion years, give or take 0.5 billion years, all in the same area. And they all know this by very precise means, having to do with the half-life of, for example.
After you watch the two films that I said, you will take back everything you just said. Plus, I have completely different information than you. I have many, many different opinions. It ranges anywhere from 10 million to 300 billion years old. So you tell me which one of the options you want to choose.
The actual accredited scientists who know what they're talking about, all of them say Earth, 4 billion.
No, and carbon 14, everybody knows it's already obsolete. It's different in different it's according to the climate in different places of the Earth. The formula is changing. Plus, it can go only reverse to the best of my memory when I read about it. Only 25 years in reverse, and plus extrapolations and everything they do, all these things is not precise. I want to tell you there are two kinds of science, objective science and speculative science. All this what they say is based on speculations only. Objective science, if you checked 1,000 times what happened and it always repeat, then it's objective, you know it. You understand? But this is all based on speculations, and that's why they have so many contradictions. It's a very long arguments. Well, let's not get into it, but I would encourage you. You're in touch with me through the emails.
I'm going to listen to your lecture, but that your understanding right now is different than my understanding.
Yeah, okay, no problem. After you watch those two films, I'm almost guaranteed that you will be more extreme than me about it. Fair. Watch it. And it's not religious. You know, it's a completely secular scientist, Goy. You watch what he has to say, and plus all the other scientists, and you'll understand. Yes, you didn't speak. Okay, go ahead.
I'm understanding that there's certain phases that have to happen before we reach the 6,000 years that are all...
...years of Mashiach. The potential for Mashiach started 1700 years ago. 1770 years ago. This is when we entered the last third of the creation. The first 2000 years was Tohu Vavohu. There was no Torah yet. Nobody really know. Everybody searched for God. There were many cults worshiping the stars. Until Abraham came, it was in 1948 in a Jewish calendar. Age 52, Abraham started to teach Torah, so it was exactly the year 2000 in Jewish calendar. And then the Torah was for 2,000 years, and then 2,000 years ago, there was the time that potentially Mashiach should have come. But there is two different conditions to Mashiach. One is Berita, on schedule, and one is Achishena, prior to schedule. If we were righteous enough, the Mashiach would come a long time ago, since we didn't fulfill our obligations. Now we are not in Achishena, we're not prior to schedule, we are on schedule. Yes, who else?
There's Tetiana Meitin, that has to take a certain period.
You're talking about this 40 years, within 40 years. It will be first Tchiyata Meitim shel Chutz La'aretz, of the exiles, and then they all roll in a special tunnels that Hashem made under the oceans. All the bones will roll to Israel, and they'll resurrect in Israel. They won't resurrect in the exile. And then within 3 years, there will be also the resurrection of Eretz Israel. But there is some arguments between the Chachamim, how it's going to be and what's going to be. I have a whole lecture in the website about those days. 2 hours with all the details. Going to my website, you see it. The resurrection of the day of Mashiach, what's going to be, if we're going to have to eat, if we're going to still give birth, how long we're going to live here, how it's going to be with the evil inclination, with Parnasa, with money, with health, etc. Yes? Yes?
A very good friend of mine is a biological physicist from Weizmann, and he put it, when I asked him how he resolves, because he's a scientist, how do you resolve the, he says very simple, Hashem just made the earth look millions, hundreds of millions, but he says, but he just made it look that way. 6,000 years old.
This is exactly the words of the Ari HaKadosh, the biggest Kabbalist in the last 2,000 years. Right. He say God made the world old, like an old person. Right. It's like someone is born and he looks like 60 years old or 70 or 80, whatever it is. And everybody say, oh, this is 60 years old, but it's really a day old. You understand?
That's a wonderful explanation I'd ever heard.
There is. It's true. But I want to tell you something else. Also keep in mind that the world was covered with water. If you put your hand 2 hours in the water and take it out, it looks very wrinkled. You understand? So that could be another explanation. Yes?
You mentioned earlier in your lecture that in order for the water to come through, it needs to be precise.
Yes, 100% precise.
100%.
Yes.
We're talking about minutes, and we're talking about Zechariah right now, and all the other prophets with respect to them. Where is their timeline? There's no timeline in any of those prophecies.
No, some of them say Be'acharit HaYamim.
There's no exact prophecy. That's exactly what I'm saying. You were mentioning before.
No. I didn't say that it must give a time. I say if it gave time, then the time must happen as they say. If they spoke about general time, like the Acharit HaYamim, it could be a period of 200 years. He didn't say exactly when. It say Bayom Ahu. He didn't give a date. The Torah didn't give a date. If the Torah would give a date, automatically it will eliminate the free choice of all the people on earth. What is it like? That I'm giving you a note, you open it tomorrow, and you see that I promised you that you live until 99. You don't have, you're not in a rush to become tzaddik. You have time. When you live 90 years, you do whatever you want. In the last few years, you become the Baba Sali, you become a holy man, and that's it. You go to heaven. Why do you have to work very hard now? You understand? If a person knew when he's going to die or when it's going to be the end, by the way, speaking about this, I want you to know one more thing. God did not want anyone to know the end, how exactly it's going to be and when. For sure he didn't want. Even in a seance, when people communicate with the dead people, with the glass, and the glass is moving with the candles, there's a way to communicate with the dead people. When people ask about Mashiach and about the end of the world, the glass explodes. I heard it from few people. There's no permission to answer the end. King David asked God, tell me my end. He told him, it's clear that I'm not telling anybody his end, when it's going to be. So he told him, okay, at least tell me what day of the week it's going to be. He told him on Shabbat. So what did he do? He was sitting on Shabbat and learning Torah around the clock. When the person sits and learns Torah, the Malach HaMavet is scared. The angel of death is scared to come take his soul. He's scared from Torah. It's the opposite of Torah. So he was sitting. So Hashem had to make a noise outside like somebody fell from the stairs. And by instinct, David HaMelech got up from the Torah to see what happened. And that's when he died. When he was 7 years old. Yes?
I have two questions. I lost two parents and a second cousin in the last 2 months. You say all the righteous Jews will come back to life. Will all the Jews come back to life? And also, I see dead cop ghosts, and I'm not sure if they're Jewish or if they are. Will they come back to life also?
The second question, can you repeat?
I see ghosts.
Ghosts.
Dead cops.
Yeah.
Ghosts. Are they the boys? Are they going to come back to life also?
Okay, let's start from the second question. The ghosts that people see, and there are people who see ghosts. I know it exists because I get phone calls and sometimes I meet these people. This kind of ghosts, they are in a very serious punishment. It's called Kafakela. They are moving in space. Ghosts of righteous people, the spirits of righteous people are not running and moving in the earth. They're already in a very good place.
Can I help them?
Huh?
Can I help them?
In what way? I tell you, there is ways to help them, and I tell you a story that happened in Monsi. You know, in one lecture that I told you, I described what happened to the soul after the person died. There are a few options. One option, the soul is being reincarnated in another regular body and start another period of life with many different tests. One period, chas v'shalom, one option, as the person go to hell. And even in hell, there are 7 different sections according to what sins he made. And sometimes a person doesn't go to hell, he goes first to Kafakela. It's a place that is much worse. Only when he finishes there, he goes to hell, because hell purifies the soul and cleans the soul from all the sins. Sometimes people are being reincarnated in animals. Sometimes they are reincarnated in raw materials. Sometimes in trees and fruits. It all depends on what sins and how many times. Now, sometimes when the soul enters an animal, it suffers a lot because it's a Jewish soul connects to a spirit of the, or to a nefesh of the animal, which is a horrible suffering. There's way to help them. I'll give you a story that happened in Muncie. In Muncie, about 15, 20 years ago, there was a very, very big righteous Talmid Chacham, Rav Schwab. Zecher Tzadik Livracha, Rav Shimon Schwab. His brother was also a big tzaddik. Two Rabbi Schwabs, among the biggest Rabbanim in the world, both of them. What a merit to the mother that she has two sons like this. One time, one Rav Menachem Schwab, one Rav Shimon Schwab. So Rav Schwab is going to the yeshiva and he sees for 1 week there is a cat that is attached to his leg. The cat. The cat doesn't leave him alone. Everywhere he goes. After a week, he spoke to the cat and said, I know what you want. Stand right here, don't enter. I'm going inside, we'll say Kaddish for your soul and we read Mishnayot. It's helping the soul to read Mishnayot. We read Mishnayot for you, but please leave me alone.
Wait, one second.
You cannot shoot 20 questions when I didn't finish answering one. So what happened? He went in, they all said Kaddish, the cat is standing outside. They all say Mishnayot for this. After they finished, the cat turned around, crossed the street, a car came by, killed him instantly. If this story wouldn't happen in front of hundreds of witnesses, I would be embarrassed to say it. It sounds like a fairy tale. But many people saw that. It happens in front of many people, and that's become a very famous story in the world today. He told the cat, we'll say Mishnayot for you. The cat turned around, crossed the street, a car came, and he died. So you see, that after they did what they did, they'll help that soul to get rid of some of his punishment. Any more questions before we finish? Yes?
For grandparents,
yes, it's very, very productive and recommended to sponsor CDs and books and things for the memory, for le'ilui neshama. Memory, it's not so important. It's more to elevate the soul. Le'ilui nishmat of the deceased people that we know, grandparents, parents, etc. It helps them a lot. Every time a Jew learns from this disc and become better and does more mitzvot, Hashem comes to that soul and Rosh Hashanah, conclude what happened in the last year. Look, thanks to your soul, your son or grandson, look how many mitzvot my children did. And it elevates the soul to be higher and higher. Okay, I think that we cover everything. Thank you very much and good night. Yes, yes. If anybody wants to donate,